Grace and peace be multiplied to you through the knowledge of God and our Lord Jesus Christ. Welcome. Today we'll be looking at Christ as the intercourse between God and man. Christ as the intercourse between God and man, or God's intercourse with man. God's intercourse with man is in the person of the Lord Jesus Christ. When we use the word intercourse, we are talking about the intimacy between God and man, the fellowship between God and man. That intercourse is the fellowship between God and man, the blending of God with man in the person of the Lord Jesus Christ, the mingling, that is an organic union between God and man. And essentially, this intercourse actually takes place in the heart of man. Christ is the intercourse between God and man. There is no relationship, there is no fellowship, there is no intimacy between God, the Holy God, and the fallen man outside the person of the Lord Jesus Christ. It is Christ that is the actual intercourse between God and man. Outside of Christ, God would have no dealing with man. Outside of Christ, God will have nothing to relate with man. Man has no means to even approach God. Man has no means to even call upon or come in contact with God. But it is only in the person of the Lord Jesus Christ. And today, we are looking at the intercourse between God and man. God's intercourse with man in the person of the Lord Jesus Christ. Adam took man away from God. God became outward to man. Christ brought God back into man for this communion, for this fellowship, for this intimacy to continue. So this intercourse is taking place in the heart of man. That's where God desires to dwell in man. Actually, the heart is the heart of everything. God's goal in new creation is to give us a new heart. So when we are looking at this, we are talking about the intimacy that God is having with the redeemed in the regenerated heart. So this intercourse is taking place in the heart of man. That's why the heart of man is very, very critical in everything that God is going to do with man. It is from the heart. That's where even the Lord said that all manners of sin comes forth. For out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaks. It is with the heart we pray. True prayer is from the heart. True worship is from the heart. True giving is from the heart. Salvation is from the heart. It is the heart we used to believe. So we can see everything about a man. The definition of a man is actually the posture of his heart. It's the condition. The heart defines the man. Whether a man is good or bad is a function of his heart, not his height, not his stature, not the color of his skin. What a joy. So the two testaments reveal essentially the two ways in which God has intercourse with man. So we have the Old Testament and the New Testament. In the New Testament, God said that he that none shall teach his neighbor know the law, but they all shall know me. I believe that word know, it's an organic union, almost like you could almost use the word in the sense that the intercourse between God and man, because the scripture tells us Adam knew his wife. So God wants us to know him in an intimate way, not just a doctrinal knowledge, just like the Lord Jesus was praying in John chapter 17, that they may know you, the only true God, and Jesus whom you have sent. So they essentially, the two testaments were revealing. It was an outward communion, I could say, in the Old Testament, because it was types and shadows, because man had fallen. But in the New Testament, God made that reality of an inward communion with us in the person of the Lord Jesus Christ. God would have no intimacy with man outside of Christ. No relationship exists between God and man outside of Christ. Actually, the currency by which God uses to relate with man is the person of Christ. That is the way to God. That is the truth about God. That is the life about God. God has no form of communion. God has no form of relationship outside the world becoming flesh, outside Christ as the God manifested in the flesh. So there is no intimacy, no intercourse between man, between God and man outside of Christ. So intercourse, essentially, we could just define it again in different aspects, is God pouring himself into man, God dispensing his life continually. It's not a one-time thing, it's a continuous thing that God wants to do, because that was the essence of man's creation. Man was created for God. Man was created to receive God into his spirit continually. That was actually what the tree of life was representing. The tree of life was a symbol, was a shadow of the person of Christ, so that God could pour himself continually into man. So intercourse is God pouring himself continually to us often as man opens his heart to God. That's why the Lord said in the book of Revelation that I stand at the door and knock. If anyone opens, I will come in and sup with him. God is ever looking for for medium to increase in man. Intercourse is the mingling of divinity with humanity, that is, the divine becoming one with the human. In the person of the Lord Jesus Christ, mingling is a deep form of union, or the blending of divinity and humanity. In the person of the Lord Jesus Christ. So this is an organic union we are talking about. I think in the First Corinthians chapter 6, there about the scripture was talking about that advising against sexual immorality, and almost like a parallel to which the scripture was using to describe those who have intercourse with the unbelievers that walk communion as light with darkness. But let me just go there. First Corinthians chapter 1, verse 15. Do you not know that your bodies are the members of Christ? Shall I take the members of Christ and make them members of an harlot? Certainly not. Or do you not know that he who is joined to a harlot is one body with her? Then for the two, he says, shall become one flesh. But he who is joined to the Lord is one spirit with him. Then later he now talked about the fact that our body is the temple of God. So God's goal is for an intercourse of divinity with humanity. Intercourse is God and man becoming one in the person of the Lord Jesus Christ, the divine and the human becoming one in Christ. That's why Christ is the life of God, for this union between God and man. God created man in his image so that man could be a vessel to contain God. Man could be a vessel to have God as its content, so as to be able to express God. So God's goal, everything he's doing regarding man, is to be one with man, so that man will be his expression, so that man will be his regent or his representation on the earth, not distinct from God, in terms of not an outward God, but an indwelling God in man, that wherever man is the presence of God in that atmosphere. So intercourse is for God and man to become one in Christ Jesus, in union with Christ. What a joy. Also, intercourse is God becoming one with man's spirit, like we read in that 1 Corinthians 6:17, that for he that is joined to the Lord is one spirit with him. That is God becoming one with our spirit. That is, we could almost say that for we to live is Christ, that Christ being formed in us, Christ making his home in our heart, the Son and the Father dwelling in us, making their abode in us. So the goal of intercourse is for God becoming one with man's spirit. What a joy. But he who is joined to the Lord is one spirit with the Lord, like we read earlier on, that for us, the believers in Christ Jesus, our being joined to the Lord is for us to be one spirit with him, so that our decisions, our mind is the mind of Christ. The moves we make, the decisions, the words we speak, they are seasoned with grace because we are one spirit with the Lord. We know what is in the mind of God because we are one spirit. I'm not saying every believer is there, but these are stages, these are processes. As we grow in the Lord, we will continue to begin to experience more and more of that. At that day in John chapter 14, the Lord said, you will know that I am in my Father, and you in me, and I in you. So you can see essentially all through the New Testament about God's goal to be one with man, that in that day you will know. And that day, we believe, was referring to the day of his resurrection, because he was talking to his disciples, or talking to us, the church, essentially about the things that was to come, and that was before his crucifixion. So at that day, we believe is the day of resurrection, you will know that I am in my Father, and you in me, and I in you. Essentially was coming to bring us into himself, like he said in John 14, that where I am, that you may be also, and I in you, as our indwelling Savior. Essentially for that intercourse between God and man. So speaking is God's means of intercourse with man. Essentially, the way God speaks with man, the way God has intercourse with man, is through his word, principally. So the heart is the goal of God. That is where this intercourse is taking place. And God speaks to man, and that's the medium through which he's dispensing, is pouring, is saturating, is filling man with himself. That's the goal, because the word is the incorruptible seed, and Christ has the incorruptible seed, is for God to dispense himself into man. So speaking is a vehicle for God to pour himself, to have this intercourse with man. And every man, we have a need for that. We were created for that. We were created to be indwelt with God. We were created to be saturated with God. And God, through this intercourse, pours himself into us. Now, none of them, Hebrews chapter 7, none of them shall teach his neighbor. Hebrews chapter 8, none of them shall teach his neighbor and none his brother, saying, know the Lord. That is, God wants a one-on-one interaction, a one-on-one fellowship between him and every child of his in the kingdom of God. So God is saying that, look, this is the New Testament. None of them will be saying know the law, but God wants a know is more than, it's part of increasing the knowledge of, but it's deeper than that, because we see that Adam knowing his wife, you could almost say that was a deep form of union. And God is saying that every one of his child, he wants them to know him. Jesus prayed for this in John 17, 2 and 3. So for all shall know me, from the least of them to the greatest of them. From that Hebrews 8, that from the least of them to the greatest of them, all shall know me. So God doesn't want there to be a situation whereby there is a second knowledge. That it doesn't mean that we don't listen to people, we don't learn about God from other people, because we are growing. We need that. We always need, because we are members of the body. God has given the fivefold ministry gift to the church for the edification of the saint. But this inward knowing, this in God's intention and plan is that we have a one-on-one knowledge of him. He can use different vessels like our pastors, anointed materials and books to boost our knowledge, to boost our concept and our knowledge base of him. We were redeemed for a life of continuous intercourse with God. That's the essence of our redemption. To me, in my opinion, that the essence of our redemption is for God to pour himself into us. So when we think about the word intercourse, let it be at the back of our mind that it is God pouring himself into us, pouring himself into the redeemed, pouring himself into the believers, pouring himself into his saints, so into his sanctified ones continually. That's the goal. I wake up in the morning, you wake up in the morning, and Lord, my heart is open to you. Please dispense yourself afresh into me. Fresh oil, Lord. Fresh oil, Lord. Oh, what a joy. And the principal means he does that is through our fellowship with him in the place of worship, prayer, studying, meditation, which we also talk about later in this teaching. Everything Christ is for God's intercourse with man. So essentially, we could say Christ is a lot of things for this intercourse between God and man to be a reality. We said earlier on that God would have no intercourse with man outside of Christ. Christ is the material. Christ is the person. He is the way for this intercourse between God and man to be a reality. The first one we look at is Christ is the word that dispenses God into man. So the goal of intercourse is for God to dispense himself into man, for God to saturate man with himself. And Christ is the word, the incorruptible seed of the word that actually dispenses God into man. Actually, how often that God has intercourse with man, I don't think it's dependent on God. I think it's dependent on we, on man. It is how often man opens his heart, how often man yields to the workings of the Spirit of God for God to pour himself afresh in us. So Christ is the word, is everything. So Christ is the word to dispense God into man. Christ is also the life that facilitates God's intercourse with man. We're organic beings, and there is a life that is actually flowing in us, that is actually flowing in God. That is the life of God, and this life of God is just the very person of Christ. So Christ is the life of God, the eternal life, the Zoe life that facilitates this intercourse between God and man. So as often, unrestricted, that we want to have fellowship, communion, interaction with God, intimacy with God, the life that facilitates, that makes that happen is actually already in us, and Christ is that very life. What a joy. Christ is also the living water that fills man with God. He said that if any man thirsts, let him come to me and drink. For out of their belly, those who drink out of, who believe in him, out of their belly, rivers of living water will be flowing. So essentially, Christ is the living water for man to be filled with God. So we can see a lot of things the scripture tells us about Christ, who Christ is. So if we think about who Christ is, let our mind go, oh, it's for God to pour himself into man. Christ is the word for God to pour himself into man. Christ is the life for God to pour himself into man. Christ is the living water for God to pour himself into man. Christ is the living bread for God to pour himself into man. Christ is the light, the true light that transmits God into man. So intercourse cannot take place without God pouring himself into us. And God uses, or Christ is the means through which God dispenses himself into man. So we worship the Lord. We adore the Lord for this great intimacy that we have with God the Father in the person of God the Son through God the Holy Spirit. So Christ is that true light that transmits God into man. What a joy. The Holy Communion meal is for God's intercourse with man. So we can see a lot of things in the Bible, especially many things in our act of worship. Holy Communion is part of it, whereby the breaking of the bread, the body of the Lord, and the blood of the law. And so when we are partaking of that, that is God pour, those are means through which God to pour himself into man. So the Holy Communion meal, or the Lord's meal, is for that. Prayer is for man to have intercourse with God. So prayer is essentially a communion between God and man, the divine and the human. That is a means whereby God pours or fills man afresh with his spirit. Like he said in the book of Acts, as they prayed in the spirit, they were all filled with the spirit. So we can see that God's intention for giving us the gift of prayer is a gift from God to man. Prayer is a platform from God to man for man to have intercourse with God. We exchange our weakness for the strength of God in the place of prayer, in the place of this intercourse between God and man. Access into the holiest of all was for us to come to have intercourse with God. It's called the holiest of all. It's a secret place, and so that it's not for everybody, but for us, the saints and the believers in Christ Jesus. So prayer is for man to have intercourse with God. Meditation is man's spirit having intercourse with God. I'm sure as believers in Christ Jesus, you practice meditation in the Word of God. What a powerful act or powerful practice whereby we express God anew, because your spirit man is just rejoicing, especially when the rhema breaks through. As your spirit man, it rejoices. There's some kind of indescribable feeling, joy, adoration, praises just goes from our hearts to the Lord. So we let the Word of Christ dwell in us richly, so that we continue to have meditation, which is us having intercourse with God, our spirit man. The gospel is God becoming one with man. The good news which the Lord Jesus Christ brought, which his kingdom brought, was that God has now become one with man in Christ Jesus. God doesn't want to be a distant father to man. God doesn't want to be an outward God to man. God does not desire to be a remote God to any mortal man. In Christ Jesus, through the gospel, man can now receive God. Man can now become one with God in the person of Christ Jesus, because we are members of the body of Christ. Christ is the way for God's intercourse with man. There is no other way for this intercourse to happen. Christ is the very way, and it's also the life that actually facilitates it, and it's also the word that is being dispensed into man. That's why we say Christ is a lot of things for this intercourse between God and man to be a reality. Christ is high priest for God's intercourse with man. God dwells in unapproachable light. God dwells in a realm where man cannot approach. But Christ, as our high priest, is able by his righteousness to bring us faultless, holy, before the holy God, so that we could have God dispensed into our being. So Christ is high priest for God's intercourse with man, because it is through his righteousness that we approach God. Christ, as bishop of our soul, is for God's intercourse with man. Because as we said earlier on, this intercourse is actually taking place in the inner being of man. So Christ is the shepherd and the bishop of our soul for this intercourse to be a reality, as 1 Peter chapter 2 tells us. So he's bishop and shepherd, is the guide over our soul, so that continually he is ensuring that our soul, as not as often as we give him the space to do it, he doesn't just usurp himself on us, but he works in us both to will and to do for his good pleasure. Christ is our life for this intercourse between God and man. Colossians 3:4. Christ, who is our life, so that it will be a life, a continuous life of intercourse with God. So he is a lot of things to us for God to dispense himself into us. Christ is our vine. That is, as this intercourse is taking place, God is supplying us the nutrient, the needed nutrient, the supply that is needed for us to be able to fulfill destiny in life. He said, those who drink of him, out of their belly shall flow rivers of living water. So something should be coming out of us that is a blessing to generation. A fruit should be coming from us that is healing nations, and Christ as the vine supplies the nutrient, so that God can dispense himself anew into us through his intercourse with us. Christ as the spirit in us is for God's intercourse with us. 1 Corinthians 15:45 says the last Adam became a life-giving spirit. That is, a spirit that gives life, a spirit that is dispensing life, a spirit that is pouring more of God into us. So Christ as the spirit, now the Lord is the spirit. Christ as the spirit in us is for God's intercourse with man. What a joy. Christ is also our righteousness for God's intercourse with man. As our righteousness, we can appear before God holy, blameless before the Holy God. Why? Because Christ is the garment of righteousness we wear in the presence of the Father. What else is Christ to us? His words, as John 6:63, his words are spirit and life for God's intercourse with man. So when it's like we said earlier on, that speaking or the word of God is the principal means through which God is dispensing himself into us or having this intercourse, and the intercourse is taking place in our hearts. The seed is actually the word of God, which is spirit and life. So his words are spirit and life for God's intercourse with man, for God to pour himself into man. So once we're using the word intercourse at the back of our mind, let's have the concept that God is dispensing himself. God is pouring himself into man. God is filling man with himself so that man will be his expression wherever he goes. So that man will be his aroma, his fragrance, his living epistles wherever he goes, the redeemed man. Union with Christ is for God's intercourse with man. God would have no fellowship with man outside of Christ. So the essence of our union, one of the critical essence of our union with Christ, is for this intercourse to be a reality. Because the Father, like he said in that John 14, that I am in the Father and you in me and I in you. So it is through union with Christ that this intercourse takes place. What a joy, what a joy. Christ's crucifixion paved the way for God's intercourse with man. So the crucifixion of the Lord, this part of the things, I believe that this was one of the joy that he was endured. This was one of the reasons I believe in Hebrews 12:2 that says that he endured the cross because of the joy that was set before him, the glory that was set before him. So his crucifixion was with the aim that, look, what I'm achieving is for God and man to become one. So he offered his life. You can imagine the gruesome price that he paid for that to be a reality. The new covenant is for God's intercourse with man, an organic union. Like he said, none will say to his neighbor, know the law, but for they shall all know me, from the least of them to the greatest of them. So the new covenant is essentially God giving man a new heart, where actually he intends to pour himself into man. So the new covenant is essentially God's intercourse with man. What a joy. The word of God is for God's intercourse with man. That is our access. So as often as I meditate on the word of God, I'm praying over the scriptures, I'm fellowship, I'm singing acts of worship based on the revelation that the Holy Spirit shows from the word, I'm having an intercourse with God. So God giving us the word is not just for us to just maybe see it as just any other book, any other secular book. No, it's for us to have an holy intimacy with the Father, because the word is God himself. Also, Christ being formed in us is through God's intercourse with us. So Galatians 4:19, that my little children, whom I travail until Christ be formed in you. Christ cannot be formed in us without God having intercourse, without God pouring more of himself into us. It is God dispensing himself continually into us that makes Christ to be formed in us. And as Christ is formed in us, we are being conformed to his image, and we become the expression of God in any environment. We become the light in any environment. We become the kings in any field God has sent us. That is, we become authority figures in any area of life that God has positioned us. So Christ being formed in us is through God's intercourse with us. Christ dwelling in us is for God's intercourse with us. That's the why he's dwelling in us, because he's in the Father and the Father is in him, and he's making his home in our heart. So Christ dwelling in us so that it won't be a remote kind of a relationship, a distant intimacy. No, that's not what Christ died for. He died for an organic intimacy, an unrestricted access to the Father. So Christ dwelling in us is for God's intercourse with man. Whether we're in the car, whether we're at home, whether in the boardroom, in any way, the moment our heart's position, the posture turns towards God and we behold him, we are having this continuous intercourse with God, whereby God is pouring himself anew and afresh in us. Man created in God's image is for God's intercourse with man, because everything was created after its kind. Only man was not created after its kind. Everything in creation in Genesis 1 was created after its kind. The goat after its kind, the lions, everybody after its kind. But for man was not created after its kind. Man was created after the kind of God. Man was created in God's image. Man was created in God's likeness, according to God's image and likeness, so that God could dispense himself into man. So that God, because God knew that one day he was going to become one with man, so that the expression of God could be true man having God as its content. His blood is for God's intercourse with man. He shed his blood for this intercourse in the Holy Communion, in the Eucharist meal, where we remember the death of the Lord. We are remembering the Lord so that because he said in John 6 that he that eats my flesh and drink my blood abides in me and I in him. His life is for God's intercourse with man. So almost everything we could say about the Lord Jesus Christ is for this intercourse, this intimacy, this dispensing of God into us to be a reality. He said, I have come that they may have life and they have it abundantly. His word is for God's intercourse with man. The incorruptible seed of the word of God is for God to dispense himself into man. It's for God to pour himself continually into us. His spirit as well is for God's intercourse with man. It is through the Spirit this becomes a reality, because the Spirit is the Spirit of truth, the Spirit of reality, to make this intercourse a living reality. That's why our fellowship is with the Spirit. Our fellowship is with the Son. Our fellowship is with the Father. God is one, but trying. What a joy, what a joy, what a joy. His priesthood is for God's intercourse with man. The priesthood essentially is to not nourish us, to minister God into us, to take care of our total well-being, of anything relating between man and God. Like Hebrews chapter 5 say that a high priest is needed so as to be able to take care of anything pertaining to God. Anything that has any relationship, the high priest is the person that represents God before man, before God, and God before man, whereby he's able to bring the sacrifices of men before God, and God now dispenses himself afresh into us through the priesthood of Christ. His word is God's seed, the incorruptible seed. Man's heart is God's destination. There are many things that should be coming from our life, blessing millions, nations all over the world. But the womb for this thing to be conceived is actually the heart of man. The seed is the word. So that's why Satan is always targeting the heart. Matthew 13, about the parable of the seed sower. The heart is very critical. The heart is God's destination. The seed is the word. So continually, we are planting the word in our heart. That's why the psalmist said, your word have I hidden in my heart that I might not sin against you. Christ is one spirit with us for God's intercourse with us. So he's one spirit with us for this intercourse not to be something of a timetable, a periodic thing. God wants it to be. That's why I say pray without ceasing. That's why he said that in everything we give thanks. We are praising God continually. Hebrews 13:15, that let us continually offer the sacrifice of praise, that continually let us let the word of Christ abide in you richly, so that our song is made, our heart is making melody to the Lord continually. What a joy. In this holy intercourse, God dispenses himself into man. God pours himself afresh and new into every mortal man. God saturates us with himself in this holy intimacy. What a joy. Access to into the holiest is for the intercourse with God. So God, the veil of the temple was rent, the holiest of all, so that God could have an intercourse with man. And it is in the person of the Lord Jesus Christ. So our being given access into the very presence of God is for this intimacy to happen. As often as we want, as believers in Christ Jesus, we open up our hearts, and right there, we are receiving God into us. We are fellowshipping with God, praying in the Spirit, meditating, worshiping the Lord, praising the Lord, and God is pouring himself afresh, because we need that fresh spirit, that fresh life God is pouring into us, for us to be able to fulfill our destiny, for us to be able to express God in every environment we go. Just like we said in the beginning, Christ is the intercourse between God and man, and this intercourse is taking place in the heart of man. So in summary, today we've been able to look at God's intercourse with man. We said this intercourse is the fellowship of God with man, the intimacy, the holy intimacy between God and man. God created man for this purpose. Man fell in the Garden of Eden through disobedience, and Christ came to restore this intimacy which God wants to have with man. So today we can not pride ourselves, but we can boast in the Lord. We can rejoice in the Lord that we are a people that is having an holy intimacy with God. What's the essence of this intimacy? Is for God to pour himself continually into man, into every aspect of our being. Intercourse is God pouring himself into man, God having fellowship with man, God having communion with man. And the principal means God uses for this is the word of God. The word of God is for God to pour himself, to saturate man, to dispense more of God into man, like the Lord said that the words are spoken unto you, they are spirit and life. So when God is speaking to us, when we are meditating on God, when we are hearing anointed teachings from our local churches, from our pastors, from anointed vessels, God is using different platforms, social media and YouTube and what have you, God is pouring himself afresh. Like Ezekiel said that the Spirit entered into me when he spake unto me. So when God speaks, his speaking is equivalent to himself. His Spirit is equal to himself, because his ear and his word, they are one. God pours himself into us principally through his word. Christ is this intercourse between God and man. Without Christ, no intercourse exists between God and man. Christ is the word for this intercourse. Christ is the light for this intercourse. Christ is the life for this intercourse. Christ is the spirit for this intercourse. Christ is our righteousness, is our vine for this intercourse to be a reality. What a joy today that we're a people indwelt by God. We're a people that God deemed fit, but in his mercy and his grace, to pour himself continually into us, so that we'll be his expression everywhere on the surface of the earth. What a joy. Hallelujah to God the Father. Hallelujah to God the Son. Hallelujah to God the Holy Spirit. God's intercourse with man. Christ is the intercourse between God and man. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah.